All right. Welcome back, everybody. Sports Chat 503. Thank you guys very much for watching. First time, long time. By the way, I appreciate it coming live from Portland, Oregon, trying to break things down here. We're the day after the Alamo Bowl. We're on to bigger and better things now, folks, aren't we? The Dan Lanning era has started officially. Again, really appreciate all you guys out there. Thanks again for all the people. I jumped in the live on the Alamo Bowl halftime. Had a really fun time there. And I'll try to do some more of those. My son, he's a sophomore in high school. He's trying to tell me all the tricks of trade of how to set up a premiere for a live and then do how to do this, that, the other. I want to really try to get more interactive as we go in the off season here and build it for a really great year next year. Really try to build as much sports chat for you guys as possible and get this ball rolling. Again, let's do it, things, man. So, let's talk about the coaching update. Again, I've heard from a bunch of people out there that they like the fact that I'm blowing up the feed, that I'm putting out content every day. I think that's great. I've got things to do. You've got things to do. We're all busy out here, but I will try to chew up a little bit of time here for you guys talking about whatever we're talking about. But I'm not here to waste time. I'm not here just to talk to talk. If there's information out there we should be covering, then let's talk about it. If there's not, then we don't got anything to talk about. Let's go ahead. First things first is these coaches, they keep coming, man. And I like what I'm seeing. You know, real early on, I made a comment when they first hired Dan Lanning, the first two hires, right out of the gate, offensive coordinator, defensive coordinator. And I made a comment saying, hey, I'd like to see some diversity in this group. There were three, you know, white guys that were 35 years old. And again, I'm a white guy too. I'm speaking on the team. But I said, hey, I'd love to see a lot of different backgrounds, cover a lot of different area of the country. And I was really concerned at that point that maybe it was too SEC focused or too East Coast focused. I'd like to see some West Coast connections. And we've seen a lot of that. This staff is very diverse. This staff covers a lot of territory in the country. This staff has a variety of different ages that it's working on. Obviously, the core of the group, the head coach, two defensive offensive coordinators, are in their 30s. But there's a lot of other guys that have a lot of experience after the fact. And the guys that they announced today are really intriguing characters. The first one that comes up is Carlos Locklyn. This guy is an absolute stud. Carlos Locklyn, you got to look this guy up. I'll post maybe a couple things in there if you can, but just go to YouTube, check him out. This guy was in law enforcement for years. Wanted to get involved with coaching, started working with youth coaching. Got together with Tennessee Chattanooga, when he was young as a player, 4-year starter there. Letterman got his little cup of coffee in the NFL, went to the Arena League, but then he really wanted to get involved with coaching, so he went to coach youth coach while he was in law enforcement. He's just being a regular guy, like we all are, right? And if any of us out here who are volunteer coaches, or anybody out here who's coaching youth, you know, you're doing your regular gig, and then you're going to coach in the afternoon or in the evenings. And he says, hey, you know, he's in Memphis, and he's working in law enforcement in Memphis, and he goes down to Mike Norvell's the coach at Memphis at that point. He goes out and says, hey, I want to work with, you know, your program in whatever shape or form I can. The guy's absolutely yoked up. I mean, the guy's ripped. You should check out these guys' images, right? So he spends the first year volunteering in the weight room. A great first place for him to start. Mike Norvell says, I'll try to find a spot for you, right? Next year, gets hired on as an offensive analyst. Then he goes in and becomes director of high school relations. Does that for a year or two. And then he goes to Florida State and basically does that same thing. He goes to Western Kentucky to be a running backs coach. Has not been a running backs coach that long. Again, I think when you're looking at what do you get out of a coach, are you looking for character? Or are you looking for skill set that he's providing professionally? This is a guy who's full character. This is a guy who's going to recruit fairly well for you. But this is a guy who I think people want to be a part of his squad. And he is a leader. I think he's going to demand perfection. I think guys like Byron Cardwell are going to really like this guy. I think that his temperament is such that he is a relationship guy. He's a player's guy first and foremost. And I think he's going to do some amazing things for this group. Now, again, you've got some serious talent here. You've got two question marks about your juniors if they're coming back next year with CJ and Travis. We've talked about that before. We may think that CJ might go. Travis might 50-50 or whatever. But you've got Sean Dollars coming back with Byron Carwell next year. That's going to be a great 1-2 punch, even if either of those guys, Travis or CJ, don't come back. Obviously, you know what you have. You've got Trey Benson in the room. You've got Seven in the room. If you think that he's going to continue to be a running back, or he could be, again, the hybrid. So there's a lot of talent in that room. And then guys coming in as well. So I really like Carlos Locklyn, Coach Lock. He is a nice one. And again, the Mike Norvell tree is alive and well here. And, you know, it's just, again, one of those things where there's guys who are going to go into their coaching tree, and they're gonna kind of go from where they're comfortable. And Mike Norvell's got a group here with a bunch of guys. That Memphis connection is going to be big there. And I think it's... we'll see how it goes. But again, I there was talk early on about maybe LaMichael James saying his name, and I had a kind of a comment about that, saying, well, it would be great to see him on staff, but I wouldn't like to see him coming right out of his industry, going right into the college rank. I think he should work his way through it a little bit. This is a guy who's an opportunity. Shows you don't have to work that much to get there. He's now the head running backs coach at Oregon, and he has very little experience as that position. But I think he's going to do really well. It could be partially because he's got such talented backs to work with. Drew Mehringer is another guy who came in today. This is the tight ends coach. This is a guy who's really interesting. Been around a long time. Seen a lot of different things. You know, tight ends is a unique group. And our last coach, the tight end coach, was also special teams coach. This coach is just going to be straight tight ends. Mehringer is going to be a real force because he's got some real talented players. Again, two freshmen in the same class that saw a lot of minutes this year in Maliki and Terrence Ferguson. Both those guys looked really good. Spencer Webb looked good after the injury. Cam, obviously, is looking to come back for whatever is a seventh or eighth year at this point. But he's still got years of eligibility. Patrick Herbert was injured. He's obviously there as well. And you just saw a lot of versatility in that room. Hopefully, this is a room that continues to grow, continues to get young bodies in here. And I really like what the tight ends are working with. So let's talk about Coach Mehringer a little bit. Went to Rice. Then transferred over as a GA after he got hurt at Rice. Went to Iowa State as a GA. Went to Ohio State as a GA. 2010, 2011, 2012, 2013 for Ohio State. Then goes to James Madison, co-offensive coordinator, quarterbacks coach for a year. Goes to Houston for a year, wide receiver coach. Goes to Rutgers for a year as a offensive coordinator, quarterbacks coach. Goes to Texas as wide receivers coach, and then goes to Florida Atlantic, co-offensive coordinator, wide receiver coach. Goes to New Mexico, co-offensive coordinator, quarterback coach. So it's interesting to see him bounce around a variety of different positions on the offensive side. I think he's going to have a pretty well-rounded perspective there. Guy's pretty fired up. I like what I see in his interviews. Again, I just go immediately to the interviews. I contact some of the people who I know who've got some connections in college football, but I just go to the interviews a lot of times. I learn a lot from these guys on just their demeanor, their body language, how they carry themselves, and how they talk about their players. A lot of these guys talk about relationships, 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 relationships. Being a good father, I hear all the time from these guys. So it's good stuff. Okay, Joe Lorig's the other guy. Special teams coach, going to be the inside linebacker coach. This is going to be an interesting one because you obviously know that Dan Lanning is going to have a special place with the linebackers. Being the head coach, he's not going to be obviously connected that much with the position coach. So this was a guy that was really important. This was a guy who, in my mind, it felt like one of the most important positions on the defensive side is this linebacker position, because these linebackers are so awesome, right? The linebacker core at Oregon right now is one of the best you've had in years, and a collection of talent right now that is few and far between here. So it's going to be really important to see what he can work with. Obviously, you know, you've got Noah Sewell coming back, basically the leader of the whole defense. You've got Justin Flo coming back off of an injury, who's going to be absolutely hair on fire, apex predator, ready to go. You've got Jackson LaDuke, who's ready to go, coming off of an injury. You've got a bunch of other guys ready to play. Keith Brown as well played a lot of really quality minutes this year. And that's all these young guys, okay? And then you start to kind of understand. Maybe you got some older guys you can try to work in here to the mix a little bit. But for the most part, you've got a lot of young guys. You know, Drew Mathis was out the whole year for the most part. Justin Flo's out for the whole year. So there were a lot of guys that got to play. You know, big question mark is what do you do with Jeff Bossa, right? So Bossa played so well up front, helping out with the linebackers, moving from safety. Do you move him back to safety? Do you keep him up front? I mean, you got a lot of room to work with. So let's talk about Coach Lorig. So Coach Lorig comes in. He's coming from Penn State, but his real damage was at Memphis. He was a special teams coach at Memphis, and they were good. Top five in most all categories. Really strong special teams is a major, major, major tool for success in any level of college football, high school football, professional football. Special teams is a big deal. I mean, Oregon is still going to lose that Utah game, but that special teams blunder at the end of that half, letting Covey go for that touchdown, was the nail in the coffin. You didn't even get into halftime yet. So, you know, you have to have your special teams locked down. You also didn't really see that much explosive special teams play at Oregon. Early in Cristobal's tenure, you saw a couple of them. Mikhail Wright had a couple big ones. But there was a time at Oregon where there was a lot of really good special teams play. And some of those special teams plays really flipped the game on its head and turned it in the favor of the Ducks. And we just hadn't seen that much this year. Or over the last couple of years. So it's going to be really interesting to see what he does here. He comes in, guy who's from out here, Walla Walla, Western Oregon was as a player, Idaho State for years, as a cornerbacks coach, linebacker coach, defensive coordinator as well, UTEP, Central Washington. But then he went to ASU. At ASU, he played, or he coached there, coached with Dan Lanning. Also went, was it Memphis? Coached obviously through the Mike Norvell tree right there as well, 2016-2018. Special teams coach as well. Did a stint at Utah State in between those. And then went from Memphis to Penn State, where he comes from Penn State over to Oregon. So, again, I think there's a lot of really, really talented coaches on this coaching staff. Key positions, important positions. I think safeties, historically, cornerbacks and whatnot have really thrived on special teams. It feels like they get to have the ball in their hands and get to be part of somewhat of the offense a little bit there. So it'd be really interesting to see who they incorporate in the next couple years. Obviously, running backs, wide receivers have done that as well. I'm talking about punt returns, kickoff returns. But it would be interesting to see how they go about using those players. I went back and watched some of the Memphis stuff from the years that he was there, and they were very explosive. Not only returning the ball, but also in coverage. So really exciting to see if we could bring a special teams element to this new coaching staff. Again, I loved Mike Bilotti's line, special teams be special. And he would put starters on special teams. Every starter had to play at least one special teams. And I do think that's an important concept to get your guys out there, get them flying around, getting them to play kind of different roles than they're used to playing. And it would be great to see the special teams really take off for Oregon. So, all right, guys, thanks for watching Sport Chat 503. We'll keep it posting, keep it going here. Happy holidays to everybody, and Happy New Year's. Thanks, guys, for watching Sport Chat 503. Adios.